Thank you for joining us to our eChurch family, MFM family, and our friends around the world. We love you. God bless you.
Now, you know, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. And I know, Pastor, they are already glad because they are tuning into this service. God bless you.
Bless you. Hallelujah. To our eChurch family, thank you for tuning back in. To our Mountaintop family that's in the room, raise your hands to heaven. Father, we bless you now. Thank you for your grace you've set on us to come from far and near, even those that are here for the very first time, even those that are tuning in by the airways for the first time on our various platforms. Strengthen us this morning. Send this word. Let it heal, comfort, strengthen, and deliver. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank God for no ordinary worship. This is a real... Amen. God bless you. May be seated at this time. We honor the Lord and we're so grateful to be back in the house of the Lord, and thank God for you that, of course, have come to be a part of the service on today. We have something I want to share with you at the end of this service, but I want you to keep your minds on this week is the week of our consecration of Oh Give Thanks. Oh Give Thanks, the time of prayer, fasting, consecration. As a church body all across the country, other pastors that do not set this platform of corporate prayer and fasting, they jump in on us or with us, and we all flow together. The information should be on your website. If you would like to take a pamphlet in your hand this morning, if you just have to, there's some of these in the lobby that will give you instructions on what's happening during the time of Oh Give Thanks. Just for checking the record, how many have never gone on this journey with us for a week of church-wide prayer and consecration? How many have done this before? Okay, the church is back in the church. Excellent. So it's nothing new to you. This is a time really you focus in on yourself and make sure you get close to the Lord, reading the word. Cut off unnecessary distractions. Usually we would say get off of Facebook, but now we've built all these platforms for communication, so you have to be on Facebook, but just avoid unnecessary distraction and avoid people that's asking you to cash app them. And focus in on spiritual things. Amen. Somebody said it's going to be a great week. Oh, come on, say it with a little bit more enthusiasm. It's going to be a great week. If you get weary along the journey, you can't really go strong in fasting, then prayer and consecration, reading your word, but a spiritual gauge. Amen. Amen. Dr. House is out. She's traveling and went to visit some of her sisters. She should be back in later today, but we thank God for traveling mercies. And for you that may be traveling as well, pray that you are safe as you are traveling. Amen. Don't say that. Okay. This morning, I want to share with you a message in the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. It is here we bring your attention to the 40th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Ministered this text on several occasions, but I thought we'd come back by it once again and see what the Lord will say to us out of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. When you have it, say, I got it. eChurch friends, share this service with somebody. Tell some family and friends to get online now and enjoy this word for encouragement. The Bible speaks to us in Isaiah 40. Go to the end part of verse 28. The whole chapter really is the view of what He is speaking to us about in verse 28 through 31, and for flow and rhythm, I'll get it from the King James Version. Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching to his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. And they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And all the people said, Amen. God works in the wait. God works in the wait. Say that back to me. God works in the wait. It is in this, I pick up one more reading out of the NIV. I want to pick up verse 31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They shall soar on eagles, on the wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. God works in the wait. Waiting is to stay where you are. It is to declare our delay of actions until a particular time or until something else happens. It's a period or a time of waiting. Elijah the prophet had to wait by the brook until the brook dried up. And then God gave him the next assignment, but he did not move until the brook dries up. Don't be angry with your boss and walk off that job. Just wait to see if God's going to make you the supervisor. And then when God says move, you move. I believe one of the most valuable lessons I have been learning over this past 8 months is how to wait on God. I know this waiting subject is not really keen for a lot of us, but we're going to get through it together. I had to accept that God was using his strategies in the midst of this chaos. He does something different than what I would do. I had to know how to allow God to take me through the transitions and through the changes while he is setting the stage for the next season of my life. Isaiah, whose name is Jehovah is Savior, he's a Hebrew prophet, believed to have been some 700 years before Jesus Christ was born. He prophesied of this coming Messiah. He speaks here in the 66th chapter of Isaiah, verse 1. He finds his calling and to become a prophet. Paraphrase the text. He says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord. In the year that King Uzziah died, it was a time of moral decay and decline of holiness. Isaiah says, I saw the Lord, but I just not see him in any extraordinary position. I saw him high and lifted up. His train filled the temple and his robe filled the temple, or his glory filled the temple. I believe the glory of the Lord is coming back into the house and to fill the temple and every vessels, but is in that waiting position while God is working. You see, waiting on God is kind of like a decay or a declining in a season where I don't know when he's going to step in. God will not leave you ashamed, though, because he said, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. As you wait, you can depend on God and get ready to get to the next height and level that God will bring you to. But the glory of his presence come back into the house. It is in this particular storyline of Susan Sturgeon, the wife of Charles Sturgeon. She writes, get an encouraging word from the Lord. He speaks to her and says, the Lord has strewn or scattered throughout the pages of his word the promises of his blessing to those who wait for him. And remember, his slightest word stands fast and sure. It can never fail. So, my soul, see that you have promises undiminished, and your hope is given in the confidence of him who said, and this is what she was bringing us to, they shall not be ashamed that wait for the Lord. She's reading out of Isaiah 49 and verse 22, where God is speaking to his people. God is proving to the world that he is God. And I believe that's what God's doing right now. By doing the impossible, he proves that he is God. Causing Isaiah 49, verse 24, warriors that have taken their captive to release their captive and let them go free. And not only that, he makes the warriors give back the plunder they have taken. I believe God is going to make the enemy let us go and give us back everything he has stolen. Because God does these things by and through an impossible feat. If you want to check the history, go to the Exodus and see how God brought his people out. And the Bible says there was not one feeble person among them, and everybody came out loaded with gold. And Christ did it. God did it then. He surely can do it again. But he did it through impossible feats, 10 plagues, and then he gets to the final plague, and finally he tells Pharaoh, let my people go. A little more history to bore you with, to strengthen you with, I'm sorry. Isaiah is proven to be the most comprehensive prophet of the picture of Jesus Christ. He, through his writing, the eagle-eyed prophet, picks Christ up and begins to show him to us in a great way. Isaiah 7:14 talks about the virgin birth. Isaiah 9:6, he speaks of there about unto us a child is born, son is given. In Isaiah 40:3-5, the glory of the Lord is revealed. In Isaiah 61, he proclaims the good news of the Lord. In Isaiah 52:13-12, he talks about the sacrifice of death, but he also talks about a return of God's people. Even in the midst of darkness, Isaiah 60:2, the darkness is covering the earth and gross darkness is covering the people, but the light of the Lord still risen and shined upon us. Because of these chronological texts in the book of Isaiah, it stands as a hope and a testimony of Jesus Christ. Isaiah overall's theme is seen in the 12th chapter of his book. He says, behold, God is my salvation. In the 12th chapter, he goes on in verse 2, he says, I will trust and not be afraid. Say that, I will trust and not be afraid. It's a lot that he was facing, a lot that Isaiah was coming up against, but he had confidence that God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. This book breaks into three divisions. It goes on, but this morning we want to focus particularly on where we are right now. Isaiah has given an encouraging word to the people of God, foretelling the end of their exile. I pray, an encouraging word that God is working in the wait, foretelling that you about to come out of this. This will end, and it will end with a blessing and not a burden. Isaiah goes on in the 40th chapter, and he prophesies throughout this and talks about how between the people, he becomes the mediator between the people. The first two verses of the 4th chapter, if you dropped your eyes on it on your device or look in the book, it gives you the whole view of the 40th chapter. He is a hope looking beyond the captivity. He says, comfort ye, comfort my people, saith God. God wants you to be at ease and comfort even in the midst of this dark time. Don't want you to fret or worry about what the devil is doing. Sit like you're sitting right now with your arm on the back of that chair with bills to be paid. So I ain't worried about nothing. You know you got to be comfort sitting in the house of God and know the devil tried everything he could to stop you from getting here. And then when you got here, you couldn't park where you wanted to park. You had to park over there and walk over. So I got to come in here and know that God is working in the way. Go ahead. Give God a praise. He's doing something amazing. And my God, wave at somebody, say, won't God shift you? Just unscripted. Just unscripted. I want you to be over there right about now. The Lord is announcing and is pronouncing to them in Isaiah in this 40th chapter, the early part. He pronounced something wonderful to them. He tell them that your sins and your iniquities have been pardoned. You know you shouldn't have got off, but God set you got off. Give God a get off praise for just all y'all playing with me. Y'all gonna make me lecture the whole morning. Clap at somebody. Tell them, you don't know what I got off for, but he did not sentence me by my actions. He says, announcing a pardon for your iniquities and blessings would receive double for all your sins. The bigger you messed up, the greater God's going to bless you. You wasn't trying to mess up that big, but God's going to bless you over and above what you did. Mama would say, God is a good God. And the church would say, he sees here that in this context, he sees the seeds of comfort rooted in the soil of adversity. When your life seems to be falling apart, ask God to comfort you, come along beside you in the escape from this adversity. God will come and comfort you and let you face that trial or face that heartache with some sure confidence that it's a blessing waiting on God. Isaiah gives us this encouraging faith to the people of God, and the faith comes to them to wait on God. He encourages them to know who God is, and to know who God is, for it is in adversity I have learned more than in the blessing of who God is. Is there one more witness in this church? It's not all in the blessings I don't see. I don't deserve nothing, but God will bless the just and the unjust. But it's in the adversity I learned something about God. I learned I wasn't that weak. I learned I had more strength than what I thought. I learned I was closer to God than what I thought I was, because the devil was acting a complete fool. I learned that God loved me because he didn't let me die in what I was going through. He says here, the Isaiah, the encouraging words to them. He says, listen, he says, I know that God never grows weary. Know that God will increase power to the weak. Know that God will renew your strength. When it seems like you can't go any further in your struggle, God comes alongside you and renews strength and keep you pushing forward. Some of you, even this morning, don't understand how you keep going forward. But God renews you in the race. Right while you're running, God comes along and put more power on the inside of you and give you grace to get up and run your race. He is a renewer of strength. Know that God will also restore time and bring you back for the redeeming of the time that you lost. The prophet Isaiah speaks of all the benefits of waiting on God. He talks about the patience we should have is a fruit of the Spirit. But the truth of the matter, nobody actually liked to wait. So I don't care if you're the five-star restaurant are going through McDonald's and you want to get your sandwich and your fries, you don't want to wait. Matter of fact, if they told you it's going to take 5 minutes on the fries, you'll take the fries off the order and tell them to give me my sandwich. I'm talking to somebody here because I ain't got time to wait. Dr. House, bless her heart, we can go to a wonderful restaurant and the waiter comes on, the maitre d', and they try to set things up, you know, to make you feel good because you're going to pay a little extra. Let us take a little time. Do you want any hors d'oeuvres before you eat? She said, no, we already know what we want. That's why I haven't looked at the menu yet. She said, well, I'm ready to eat right now. Do you want us to get your drinks and then we'll come back? No, bring the drinks with the meal. I'm ready right now. We don't like to wait. But it's strange, not in my notes, even though we don't like to wait, if you gotta go get a petty and a medi, you're going to wait to make sure they get it right. Make sure every color is right, everything is in place, and I want you to do a good job. I'm waiting up in here. And you're not going to run out with a beauty shot with your hair wet. You're going to wait, even though you're number 7 in the line. I got to get them back to my message. Listen, we don't like to wait. That's why we have microwaves. We have instant coffee. We have fast foods. Even today, it seems there are pills for everything. Disregarding the side effects. But if this pill gonna get me big in a moment, I'm gonna take a couple of these and start working out. We don't like to wait. It is in this picture that we see the significance of waiting. Statistics have shown the average person spends closer than an hour waiting for something. Statistics have shown this. Waiting for an elevator, waiting for the traffic light, waiting for your turn at the intersection, waiting for your turn in the grocery store. Some of you have gotten so good with that, you like to do the self-checkout. Then you get mad at yourself for checking you out so late. Anyway, we don't like to wait. Hang on. Waiting for a table at a restaurant. I told you that you got to go in. They got to put your name on the list of wherever you're going to go. They'll sit you down. When you sit you down, you still got to wait. The waiter comes over and asks, do you know what you want? And you start putting your order in. I want breakfast. I want this and that for my breakfast. When they walk away from the table, you ask them, how long is it going to take? It's going to take breakfast time. I'll get it back to you. But while you're sitting there, you realize you have to wait, but you couldn't get nothing unless you put your order in. Got you right there. You're waiting on God, but have you put your order in yet? Have you told him what you need in your life? Have you made sure your menu, you looked at the menu and know that I don't want what everybody else want. I want what I want. That's how it is, waiting on God. Waiting. We wait on our computer to load up, and that's a nail biter right there. We wait for the internet to kick in. We wait for a microwave to turn on. We'll turn on and give us our products. We ain't got to turn on, give us our food, so we ain't got to turn on the whole oven. When it adds all up, they said over a lifespan, you spend 70 years, of the average person will spend 3 years waiting for something to happen. It is easy to say I trust God and respond for the delay and the frustration and difficulties when I know that he's going to come through. Are you convinced that God is listening? Do you believe that he is good? Do you accept your circumstance as a sovereign order of God's direction? Do you doubt God and really care? Do you doubt that God really cares about you? Waiting sometimes can cause frustration and become the one wonder and shift your hope and expectation off of the Lord. But Isaiah is telling us this morning, God is working in the wait. It seems impossible, not really real, to see that God is working in the wait, but he is working. Right now, some of you and I are battling through the idea of wrestling with the idea of waiting, because waiting for God is a battle. Battle of your mind, battle of your spirit, battle of your soul, believing God, even though you're being fought against. Here is a key this morning. The stronger the battle, the more you know God's getting closer. The wait's just about to be over. The Bible goes on to tell us of the embracer, Habakkuk in 2 and 3. Habakkuk, the wrestler, embracing here. He said, listen, the vision of the revelation to be revealed is but for an appointed time. But though it tarry, you wait for it, because it's going to speak in the end and not lie. Waiting on God should be a time of refreshing and refocusing, not being frustrated and being upset, but get yourself together and wait. Isn't it good to know? I don't know, but we had a little time to shut down and we refreshed ourselves. Some of you didn't want to go to work anyway, so now you got to work from home, and now you got to refocus and get yourself back together. While you're waiting on God, God is shifting your life to new levels. Levels of acceleration are taking place. When this is happening, pay attention how you respond to God. Stay intentional. Make sure you're insightful about waiting for God. Don't sit there like the bus ain't coming. God ain't the bus, baby. He's omnipresent. So be intentional, insightful. What you're waiting for? God's about to show up in my life. How do you know, preacher? Because I had a night of weeping, and it only endured for a while, but joy became in my morning. You would surprise your friends when they come over, and you get up happy, happy all day long, and say, "What you've been stuck in this place? What you're so happy about?" Because God said he's coming, and I believe that he's coming. Y'all gonna work with me? Y'all gonna let me just go through it? Good. Good, good. Stay focused on the promise. Believe God will renew your strength. I decree the blessings of Asher on your life this morning. Deuteronomy 33, I decree the blessings of Asher, that your generations will be blessed, that you will not be rejected any longer. You will be accepted among your brothers. You will not be tolerated, but you will be celebrated. I decree VIP access on everything over your life. I decree the Lord dips your feet in oil, and that your shoes be iron and brass. To dip one's feet in oil means prosperity. Anybody want more prosperity on your life? It's not just money, baby. It means to move along easy about life. I predict that you will be a warrior. You will be a person of victory. I predict this, and I decree this, that as your days, so shall your strength be. God's not going to let you fail. You're going to be a happy feet. Asher means happy feet. I need somebody to go back to the land and click your heels three. No, that's all right. But you're going to be happy feet. You're going to be so glad. You're going to be dancing with no music, because you know God is telling me my wait is over. If I'm preaching to anybody, just wave at me and say, keep talking, preacher, keep talking. It is here we see happy feet. We see the prosperous life. We see the victorious, strong life. The phase here of God is encouraging us in waiting on his word. Psalms 5 and 3, watch it with expectation. Psalms 130:5 and 6, put your hope in the word of God. Proverbs 3:5 and 6, trust in God with all your heart. Psalms 37:7-8, rest, fretting not, refrain from anger, be still and choose God's patience. In Psalms 27:13-14, be strong and take good courage. See, waiting is an opportunity to experience God on different levels. Waiting tells me that God is not a person that would leave me ashamed and not come through. In the book of Acts, around the first chapter, he told them, go back and wait for the promise of the coming of the Holy Spirit. In the second chapter, they were waiting in the upper room with expectation, praying and believing God, and the Holy Spirit came and fell in the house. When you wait on God, he will show up. Come on, Clinton, get to it. It is God that is telling the church now. He said, God is working through the waiting. God doesn't make us wait for long. He comes through. He's not fickle. He's not malice or against us. I'm just holding you here for a moment. I don't want you to mess this up. But when I break you loose, everything I promise, I'm going to hit you with it in overflow. Beloved, believe this. It's wisdom that God is working through your life. When you're waiting, God is working through your life. It increases our trust in the Lord. It looses us from perceiving that we are in control. Waiting here literally means that we're at the mercy of God, and God's timing is his timing. So if I'm waiting for him, he comes through when he wants to come through, realizing that God makes us wait. And in that waiting place, we see that God is where I'm starting to trust God to get me out of this, to get me through this. It is teaching me of my false starts. Waiting helps me learn my false starts. I ran a little track and field. I understand that you have to wait for the right time for the gun to pop for you to start running. But some of people got up and jumped the gun. You wanted to do it your way. You didn't want to wait. You didn't wait, but you went on. So God was telling you, wait, don't go too fast. I'm ready right now. You're not in the position. So it was false starts. False starts can disqualify you. Knowing this, sometimes you can only get so many false starts. You move too fast, you fool out, and you lose out altogether. Waiting. It's impatient people that release anxiety. Waiting easily, ease upon them. And they, before you know it, they're false started. They don't stay and let God do what he wants to do. I know God is working in the wait. God uses waiting to prove us, to teach us, and to train us. I'm getting you ready for something you've never experienced before. It is waiting. Abraham, Sarah had to wait for a sign. Joshua had to wait for the promotion. Moses had to wait for Israel to come out of slavery. Ruth had to wait in the fields of Boaz to get a husband. David had to wait to become a king. Elijah had to wait for the rain. And Job waited for the suffering to go through his life. And Paul tells us waiting releases us from prison. Abraham and Sarah needed discipline to understand that God wanted them to wait. Ishmael was not going to be your son. I'm going to give you Isaac. Joshua had to wait, needed to wait, languishing beside Moses. Joshua here waited, lingering beside Moses. But now he found Joshua himself going through the prison of adversity, cycles of trouble, suffering and sadness, humiliation and unforgiveness, but yet he waited till God got ready to move. Moses waited 40 years to be a shepherd. God is testing to see, can you hang with me till I get ready to move in your life? Can you slow down for a moment and let me fix your whole picture? Joseph needed 40 years working beside Moses before God released him to become a leader and be in charge. Clinton, yeah, you needed 14 years with G. Grady Benton before God released him to come to Las Vegas. Hold on, wait a minute, put some Jesus in it. When you're waiting on God, know that he will come through right on time. God is telling the church, I got you. God is speaking to the believer saying, I got you. God knows what we need of. God knows that we've been waiting a long time, but those that wait will find it very good in the end. Waiting doesn't mean you don't do nothing. Waiting means that you get prepared. You get yourself in position. God is doing something. You ain't going to the airport and ain't packed your bags. Get your bags packed. Put them by the door. Act like you're going somewhere with your ticketless self. But believe I'm about to take a vacation. So I got myself on a vacation mind. I'm putting things in order. I'm getting ready to go to the next level. I tell you all the time, you can't talk about buying a new house and you got everything settled down in that apartment. Start packing some stuff in some boxes. Get rid of some stuff you don't want to cross over. Let yourself know, I'm getting up out of here because my wait is over. But I'm waiting on God. I'm putting myself in position. I'm acting like I'm going to a new level. I'm believing God's about to shift me. Watch this. If you want to get out of debt and you know you're in a lot of debt, then start acting like you'll get out of debt. Write them bills down. Look at those hard, large numbers. Say, we're going to take this challenge one at a time. But God's about to bring us out of this debt. You ain't getting out of debt. Yes, I am. God sees it. I see it. So I'm getting out of this debt, getting out of this heartache, getting out of this setback, because God is working on your life. Remember waiting, and God is working. While you're waiting, God is working. While you're waiting, God is maturing and bringing about the promise. While you're waiting, God is maturing you and building you up. While you're waiting, God's strengthening your mind, strengthening your heart. He'll let you know when you come out this time, you never want to go back into that again. You'll look back and say, Lord, I thank you for the deliverance. I thank you for bringing me out, because the wait's just about to be over. While you're waiting, God's growing your business, getting you ready to have some new employees, getting ready to start to have a greater increase, growing you up as a suitable person. God, you're waiting. God's making you a suitable person, a suitable husband, a suitable wife, growing you up to handle wealth, growing you up to be responsible. God is growing you up to receive blessings. Preacher, why all this waiting? What am I waiting for? For they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Are you telling me, preacher, all while I was waiting, God was giving me strength for where he's taking me to? Absolutely. All while I was holding, God was working in my life? Absolutely. God was holding you up to get some folk about your life that can't go with you where God's trying to take you, putting your faith on another level, letting you know that I can do it because I'm God. I'm the everlasting Father, creator of the ends of the earth. Faint if not, neither grow weary. Young men will utterly fall, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew your strength. Feel your strength coming back. Feel your power coming back. Feel your love coming back. Feel the grace coming back. Feel the anointing coming back. Feel the power coming back. My wait is over. My mount is high, above principalities, above powers, above darkness. Devil, you had your foot on me long enough, but I feel it's mounting up time. I feel it's breakthrough time. I feel it's praising time. I feel it's go Jesus, go Jesus, go Jesus, go time. I believe this is the hour. This is the moment. God's about to raise somebody up. The enemy thought he would destroy you this time, but God ought to use him to make you stronger. Give God a strong comeback. Praise God is working in the wait. Be not dismayed. God will take care of you. Somebody, please come get me. You have no idea. To look at the door, see what I'm dealing with, and God says nobody will help you like I can. Nobody will deliver you like I can. Nobody will bring you out like I can. I promise I'm coming. I promise I'll be there. I promise you're gonna be done with this. That's the blessing of the church. God is working in the wait.